everybody who is here and to the people who are not here, who are watching via live streaming. Thank you all so much for coming to this panel. Our subject is Free Political Prisoners. My name is Margaret Kimberley. I'm from Black Agenda Report, and thank you. I'm also serving on the UNAC Administrative Committee. Just a few couple of quick housekeeping things. Reminders, our Twitter hashtag is UNAC1, that's at UNAC1. Two hashtags, no new wars, and end war at home and abroad. Excuse me, that's end war at home and abroad. We're also live streaming on GoProRadio.com and CPRMetro.org. So, why are we talking about political prisoners? It's interesting because I think the average American person would not even acknowledge that there are such people in existence. But that's not surprising. By now, everyone knows, or ought to know, that the United States is the largest jailer on earth, with both the largest number of individuals incarcerated and the largest percentage of population behind bars, with 25% of the world's prison population, but we only have 5% of the world's people. And those statistics are really inextricably linked to the subject of today's discussion. We know that mass incarceration began in earnest in reaction to the liberation movements of the 1960s and 70s. We know the war on drugs was a rationale for locking up more and more people. We know that the prison industrial complex uses incarcerated people to do more than just churn out license plates. Now they make everything from office furniture for private corporations to bullets and bulletproof vests and body armor for the U.S. military. But mass incarceration and our incarceration system is in itself deeply political. It should not come as a surprise that there are people in this country held in prison because of their political beliefs and activities. The insidious thing about the United States is that in general they aren't charged with offenses that are obviously or overtly political. Instead, they're jailed on trumped-up charges, entrapped, received draconian sentences for minor offenses, or are victimized by informants who themselves concoct the alleged crime. Some are attacked by police and then charged with crimes when they defend themselves. So, but we've seen this for many years. The FBI's counterintelligence program was a result of the freedom movement and the Black Panthers and others choosing to assert their right to self-defense. The SWAT team, every podunk community in the country has a SWAT team, and they were developed as a result of a shootout between Black Panthers and the LAPD in 1969. But lest we forget, this country was never friendly to the dissenter. Our people, we're told, are great. The past presidents, we're told, they were brilliant or wonderful, but they were slaveholders or they led genocide against the Indians or practice wars of aggression outside of the country as well. So of course there are political prisoners here, and of course their number has grown. There always is a pretext for putting and keeping people in jail. It could be the Cold War, or the Black Liberation Struggle, or an attack as happened on September 11, 2011. Now there are entirely new classes of political prisoners. George W. Bush invented the term enemy combatant in order to come up with entirely new ways to terrorize individuals, and then preemptive war, which destroyed Iraq. And his predecessor, or rather his successor, Barack Obama, has gone further. Bush claimed the right to indefinitely detain anyone who he said was an enemy combatant, but Obama actually claims the right to kill, including American citizens, and he did just that with Anwar al-Awlaki and his son. So the fight to free political prisoners is part and parcel of what we're going through now with the government, which is becoming more and more less democratic. There's nothing democratic about SWAT teams or the Patriot Act or COINTELPRO, which continues under different names. And they're part of a larger conspiracy to keep people from doing anything that allows them to truly change this system. But that's about it for me. We have a great lineup of speakers, and our time is limited, 5 to 7 minute speakers, and we're gonna remind you. And I'm now going to introduce my co-chair, Jeff Mackler, also on the UNAC Administrative Committee, many things, director of the Mobilization to Free Mumia Abu-Jamal. He's a former West Coast coordinator of the Lynne Stewart Defense Committee, and he's the author of Free Palestine and other books on U.S. and world politics. So, Jeff Mackler.
Thank you. What an honor to be here. I'm so glad Margaret pointed out that we, the government of the United States, not us, is the number one incarcerator in the world, with 7.3 million people under the jurisdiction of the criminal justice system. Half of them are in jail, incarcerated, and increasing numbers are subjected to the privatized for-profit slave labor, average 50 cents an hour, prison industrial complex, where they produce prime products for the Fortune 500 for free. In Georgia and Texas, they work for nothing. We have the largest number of people on death row in the world, and we are one of the few nations left that still has the death penalty. But we have another kind of death penalty called imperialism and colonialism, where through drone wars, privatized death squad wars, on-the-troop ground wars, sanction wars, embargo wars, and starvation wars, the United States government kills additional millions of people. In the society that we want to build, we will empty all of the prisons because everybody there is truly a political prisoner. In the society that we will build, there will be no police, CIA, drugs brought into this country in order to incarcerate people. 80% of the people in prison are there for nonviolent crimes. And those people who have been driven mad by a sick social system will be taken out of the jails, given first-rate housing, education, health care, opportunities to thrive and reach their full potential as human beings. We won't have any political prisoners in the world that we want to build. We are scheduled today to hear Skypes from a number, at least one, they said, and perhaps all of the Cuban Five. And we were informed by the government of Cuba that they are en route to other countries to speak. They are the heroes of the Cuban people, and they wrote to us to say that UNAC deserves to have the heroes of the Cuban people here, and I heartily agree. Instead, they sent a message which I'd like to read from you from the people of Cuba. Dear participants to the Conference of the United National Anti-War Coalition, UNAC, we convey to you our friendly salute on behalf of the Cuban Institute of Friendship with the Peoples and the whole of Cuba. The work UNAC does in the United States in the struggle for social justice and against military interventions in other nations is a topic of utmost importance today. The problems affecting the peoples of the world, among which we have unequal distribution of wealth, lack of medical assistance and education, unemployment, energy and environmental crises that put the very life of human beings at risk cannot be solved with wars, nor cannot be solved by military interventions. Our country, on the contrary, what is really required is the strengthening of dialogue and cooperation among nations, peoples, and governments of the world with absolute respect for international law and the free self-determination of the peoples of the world. Cuba, that has suffered military interventions, terrorist attacks, an economic embargo that is still in place, has decided to build its own model of development that emphasizes the well-being of the people, the guarantees that guarantees the exercise of the economic, social, and cultural and political rights of the people. Cuba is in the middle of updating our process of economic and social models. We aim at achieving a prosperous and sustainable socialism for all our citizens. In this context, on December 17th, the governments of Cuba and the United States decided to begin the work of reestablishment of bilateral relations, diplomatic relations. And the Cuban people received with joy the news of the return of the three remaining Cubans in jails for fighting terrorism. The Cuban Five, Gerardo, Ramon, Antonio, Fernando, and Rene, symbolize the spirit of resistance of our people and the firmness of principles that support the Cuban Revolution. The decision of the Cuban government to begin talks with our government, with the United States government, without Cuba making any concessions of principles, is due to the resistance and strength of our people, which for over five decades has built a social project each day more just and inclusive. Nonetheless, in spite of the fact that we consider as positive the steps taken by the current U.S. administration to improve relations with Cuba, the economic, commercial, and financial blockade against the island remains and constitutes the main obstacle for the development of our peoples. We will continue to fight to end this hostile and unilateral policy against Cuba, together with our friends in the United States and with other peoples of the world. Finally, we wish you a productive debate conducive to strengthening of the work of your organization, Kenia Serrano Puig, ICAP President. Thank you. I have a motion that we accept Cuba as an honorary member of UNAC. Do I have a second? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those who say no. It's unanimous, and we will communicate that to the NSA. We have now joined the League of Organizations on the U.S. terrorist list, supposedly. And if Cuba is a terrorist country, we live on another planet. Let me tell you about revolutionary Cuba. I went there as an American socialist, if I may admit, and I went to the guard post on the Central Committee of the Communist Party of Cuba, and I said, I want to talk to the leadership of your country. I do that everywhere I go, by the way. I go to the White House, I go to Paris, and I say, I'd like to speak to your leaders. And the Cubans said, welcome, and they brought me inside, and within 20 minutes, I was sitting with two members of the Central Committee of Cuba who had a file on me as a social justice activist. All the evil things that I did in the United States were good things in Cuba, fighting against racism and poverty. Cuba is the only nation in the world that mobilized 100,000 people for the freedom of Mumia, Abu-Jamal in Holguín. And Cuba is the only nation in the world that has opposed every imperialist intervention from the time of its revolution, defeated the counter-revolution, including the American invasion, and has survived what in any other place would have been a 53-year war against it, because it eliminated the whorehouse that the United States organized and supported under the Batista regime. So with that, I would like to introduce our next speaker, and I don't want to miss this. His name is Alejandro Molina. There's a special reason, not only because he is for the freedom and organizing for the freedom of Oscar Lopez Rivera, and has spent a lifetime doing it, but because Oscar was a roommate with one of the Cuban Five for 5 years in an American prison, and we wanted Alejandro to read Oscar's message to his cellmate, and we wanted to dedicate ourselves like we did to the Cuban Five's freedom to the freedom of Oscar Lopez Rivera. Alejandro Molina has organized in the Puerto Rican Latino communities in New York, Hartford, San Francisco, and Chicago around the issue of Puerto Rican political prisoners. The editor of USA on Trial, he sits on the coordinating committee of the Natural Boricua Human Rights Network and is playing a leading role in organizing the May 30th, a day for Oscar Lopez Rivera. Let's give a warm welcome to Alejandro Molina.
Buenos días y gracias. Compañeros, it's an honor to be invited to read Oscar's message here. I'll try to be brief and I'll start. Letter from Oscar Lopez Rivera, May 8th, 2015. For those of us who love justice and freedom, want a better and more just world, free of colonialism and imperialism, revolutionary Cuba has been and will continue to be a beacon of hope and an example to emulate. It is admirable that Cuba has achieved so many accomplishments in spite of the many attacks the U.S. government has carried out against its government and what it represents, including an invasion, terrorism, the killing of over 3,000 Cuban citizens, and a criminal economic embargo. Revolutionary Cuba has been able to set an example of the importance of the development of human resource, of solidarity, and of the need to defend just and noble causes. It started with a nation in shambles, with an economy in chaos, and responding primarily to the economic interests of the USA, a poor educational system, and a deficit in many important professions. But today, Cuba can send doctors and other medical professionals, engineers, teachers, and military personnel to help other countries all over the world. And its literacy program is being used in many parts of the world in order to eradicate illiteracy. It is the most literate country in all of the Caribbean and Latin America. Its praxis in solidarity is unique in the world. One act of solidarity that really reflects the generosity and commitment of Cuba and its government is what it did in Angola in order to stop the racist army of South Africa. As many as 50,000 Cuban soldiers participated in that military operation, and thanks to the Cubans, the South African army was defeated and the back of the apartheid regime broken. This was the reason why Nelson Mandela let the world know that the Cuban people and its government were the best friends he and his people had. And for us Puerto Ricans, Cuba has always been the other wing of the same bird and the greatest supporter in helping us defeat and eradicate colonialism. Cuba is the place where so many of us feel like we are home. At a personal level, I feel indebted to the Cuban government and to the Cuban people. As a Puerto Rican political prisoner, I have been the beneficiary of its generous and enormous support. I have had the honor and privilege to spend over 4 years in prison with Fernando González, one of the Cuban Five. Those 4 years have been the best and most meaningful time of the 33 I've spent in prison. Fernando was not only a compañero, but a brother. He incarnated the very best of what the Cuban Revolution has achieved. He earned the respect and admiration of many of the prisoners. They often approach me to ask how he is doing and want me to send their love and respect to him. Since Radio Havana, Cuba, just celebrated its 54th anniversary, I must mention how important the station has been to me. For many years before coming to prison and while in prison, I've been a listener of many of its programs. I want to congratulate the workers of Radio Havana Cuba for the great work it has done and continues doing. I want to thank Comandante Fidel Castro, President Raul Castro, the Cuban government and its people for all it has done and for all it has given us. Let's keep on demanding that the embargo be lifted and that Guantanamo is returned to Cuba. Oscar Lopez Rivera.
As you know, it's not an exaggeration to say that Mumia Abu-Jamal is near death. And it's not an accident. They are trying to kill him. They gave him, they never discovered after 34 years in prison that he was a diabetic, and they gave him medication to solve an eczema problem that drove his blood sugar up to 781, 11 points low, 21 points lower than going into diabetic coma. He was in diabetic shock. He could barely walk. They had to take him to the prison infirmary, and when they treated him from eczema with a drug, it exacerbated the situation, and he was near death and could barely speak, and yet he got his messages out to us via prison radio again. It wasn't the first time they tried to kill Mumia. When he approached to defend his brother, Billy Cook, who was being clubbed by a police officer, he was shot in the chest, and he lay on the sidewalk unconscious, and the police picked him up and put him on a stretcher. This is in 1981. They dropped him off the stretcher. They put it on again. They rammed his head against a telephone pole. They threw him in a van and beat the shit out of him, trying to kill him. And they had an officer, Alphonse Giordano, say, in charge, he was in charge of the scene, that Mumia said, "Yeah, I'm glad I killed the motherfucker." Giordano never testified because he was indicted, convicted, and imprisoned for being by the Justice Department and the FBI for being one of dozens of Philadelphia police who regularly intimidated witnesses, planted evidence, were involved in drugs and all kinds of other activities. And Mumia was their leading critic. And the cop mayor, chief of police who became mayor, said that they were going to hold Mumia responsible for his attacks on the Philadelphia Police Department. So Giordano never got a chance. They took him to Jefferson Hospital, unconscious, and they beat him again in the hospital. They put their foot on his drainage bag and tried to force the fluids up into his body once again, and then he survived. And 6 months later, two officers who were on the scene said, "Oh, I forgot. He confessed that he killed police officer Faulkner," whereas the medical examiner who was on the scene all the time said, quote, "In the report, the male Negro never spoke a word." They tried to execute him 3 times, but our movement stopped the execution. If it wasn't for the mass mobilization, including 25,000 people in San Francisco and Philadelphia, Mumia would not be alive today. We continue to struggle for his freedom and his very life, and now I'd like to introduce you to the single person who is the founder and leader and longtime fighter for Mumia's life and for all human rights, the founder of the International Concerned Family and Friends, of Mumia Abu-Jamal, the indefatigable fighter for the liberty of all political prisoners. Let us welcome Pam Africa.
On the move, family, and thank you. I want to point out very seriously, we got some work to do. I don't want people to be under the illusion that Mumia is in anything but dire need for our help. Mumia, they're definitely trying to kill him. They have never stopped. I visited Mumia last Saturday. And before I go any further, the conditions that Mumia is in is horrific. But Seth Hayes, Jamil Alameen, and a lot of political prisoners, Puerto Rican, Asian, and all, and people who are not political prisoners, is under very terrible health conditions. And they want us to sit by and watch. Mumia is that one in millions that can bring attention to the millions that are in there that is suffering under medical neglect. When I visited Mumia last Saturday, and I don't know how many people really know, I'm gonna try to do this fast. When his wife Wadia went to see him the week before I did, she described Mumia as barely able to breathe, walking baby steps to over where she was at. His thighs was huge. He was in constant pain. The skin problem had, you know, bust, and blood was seeping out his arms. And, you know, when I went to visit him Saturday, and things was just about the same. His legs had went down a little bit. The conditions with his skin was the same. But Mumi could walk a little better. He walked like someone who had chains around his ankles and was shuffling like this. And in terrible pain. When I saw Mumia, Mumia pulled himself together enough to try to make me feel comfortable. That's Mumia. But under these conditions, we're asking people, for those who don't know, Mumia doctor on the outside now can call Mumia and talk with Mumia. He have not been able to see Mumia, touch Mumia. He talks through a lawyer to the Department of Corrections. And had he not been able to do that, we would not have known that one of the drugs that they gave Mumia that caused the swelling and all these things that they stopped a couple weeks ago, they gave him another medication. This medication, when I was on my way to the prison, the lawyer called me, Brett Brody called me to let me know that tell Mumia to call the doctor as soon as possible. Well, what it turned out that phone conversation was about was that they had given Mumia another medication, and which side effects were very harmful. At this particular point, Mumia is refusing to take this medication. They're trying to make him sign a release form stating that they're not responsible if anything happened to him because he won't take the medication. I say they need to sign a release form saying that they are the cause of everything that is happening to Mumia. If release forms have got to be signed, you know, and the reason why the doctor can't see Mumia is behind the fact that they said that if the doctor came in to see Mumia and talk with the other doctors, they can file litigation against them at another time. I'm saying, if you're not doing anything wrong, what is your problem with another doctor coming in? Because it's clear. And some people call it medical neglect. I call it straight out attempted homicide on Mumia. When we couldn't get in contact with Mumia and the prison wasn't giving us information, people said, well, what are we going to do? This was when Wadia saw him and put out the alarm of what was going on. Prison wouldn't answer, governor office wouldn't answer. I said, call 911. There's a crime being committed here. But people was taking that lightly. I'm serious. And file a police report. A murder is happening while we sit back and look. I'm saying we're doing everything that we can within this movement to put pressure, but we got to step it up a little bit more. And because while we're waiting for things to happen and to get in the court, we got to demand. And I'm saying we got to demand and be up front and where we're visible and to demand that Mumia's doctor be allowed to come in. First demand is release Mumia because Mumia is innocent. And we do have the information to prove that. But in the meantime, I saw it. But in the meantime, let us all gather and go and do what is necessary. And to like this governor's event that they're having in San Francisco in June, where all, not governors, the mayors is coming together. I think we need to be there, lifting our voices, not only for Mumia, but for every other person. On July 25th, and on the march in Newark, we must be a part of that for all over against police brutality and every other social injustice that's happening. But please understand that this is now is the time. And we got these people pinned. All the information is there to stop this murder. Let us not take baby steps as they have forced Mumia to do, to move and to get around. Let's take giant steps, leaps, and do what is necessary. Let's come together with a plan and to actually stop this murder of Mumia and other political prisoners. Mumia, I got 1 minute and 60 seconds. Within that 60 seconds, when Mumia go to get his medication, there's 100 other men of color and poor whites that are in a medication line and are for diabetic medicine. None of them is getting a diabetic diet. That is clear genocide. When you give people a medication that you gotta have a certain, diet for, and you don't get it, and we gotta act fast now, because Mumia isn't the only one that they're killing. And we gotta put that word out. So with that, I say thank you on the move, and let's rise up. Everybody, get ready to work. Free Mumia.
Thank you, Pam Africa. Our next speaker is Mark Burton. He is a criminal defense and civil rights attorney from Denver who represents the FARC political prisoner, Simon Trinidad, who is imprisoned in Supermax in Colorado. Mark has been involved in Colombia solidarity work for a number of years and has helped organize two delegations to Colombia and one to the Colombian peace process in Havana, Cuba. So Mark will tell us how the United States government went about kidnapping a man in cahoots with the government of Colombia and now has him in a supermax prison. Mark Burton.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Recently, I had the honor to be asked to represent Simon Trinidad, who's imprisoned in my state. He's a political prisoner, a prisoner of war, a prisoner of the empire, and a member of the FARC-EP, which is the FARC People's Army. And his native Colombia is also known as the Man of Steel. And that's because of his keen intellect and his solid beliefs in his cause. The thing I'd most like to be able to do, which I can't, is to read a letter or a greeting to this conference from him. But that's not allowed. He is in Florence Supermax in an 8x11 cell, underground, cannot communicate with anyone except for a few people. He's under what's called a SAM, a special administrative measure. He can't talk to the press. He's asked to meet with the International Red Cross. Can't meet with any of them. He's not allowed to. And just I have to sign the SAM to visit him and to meet with him. I'm not allowed to bring anything he tells me to the public. And this is what we call democracy in the United States. Simon Trinidad is I'm going to tell you a little bit about his origin. He's from a quite wealthy family, not wealthy, but fairly well-to-do family. But through his activities in the 1980s, working with people in rural areas, he became very concerned about the rural working class in Colombia, in his native province of Cesar, in the north of Colombia, in the Atlantic coast region. In the 1980s, pursuant to a peace process, the FARC and some other, and many other broad front joined founded a party called the Patriotic Union, and he decided to join that. He had been a member of the Liberal Party. And at that time, he became into contact with the FARC. And what happened was that, fortunately, the Patriotic Union disputed elections, two elections, and they got too many votes that the Colombian and their U.S. masters made them uncomfortable. And there was a wave of assassinations against people in the Patriotic Union. And in fact, there's a court case of genocide in the American Court of Human Rights. Up to 4,000 other members were assassinated. Mr. Trinidad, instead of, he had a choice. He sent his family to Mexico for safety because he was starting to get death threats. And he didn't take them seriously. And he was a professor of economics as well as a banker. He, a friend of his at the university also got a death threat and was assassinated. So he decided it's time to act. I either have to leave the country or I have to join with the FARC. At the age of 37, he went to visit the FARC leadership and asked to join. And even though at his advanced age for that kind of work, he was allowed to he was allowed to join the, to join. And he he became known not as a military man, but as a thinker, as an economist, and as a peace negotiator. He was a key figure in the in a former peace talks in San Vicente del Caguán. He became a negotiator for the FARC and became very famous. And there's all sorts of statements from him and pictures of him there. But his main interest was in peace since his time as a younger man and in peace. And in 2004, he went on a peace mission to meet with a UN official in the country of Ecuador. But the Colombian government, through their intelligence, had been following him. And he was captured in Ecuador on January 2nd of 2004. He was then extradited to Colombia, and the Colombian government asked the United States government to extradite him to the United States. And their first response was no, because we don't have any crimes against him. Well, they cooked up some crimes. They did a number on him. They charged him with narco trafficking, the usual things you hear about Latin American revolutionaries or narco traffickers. All sorts of revolutionaries around the world. You know, they can't be just people who believe in fighting for justice, fighting for people. They're narco traffickers. And they also accused him of hostage taking. Well, in 2003, February 13th of 2003, the FARC had shot down a plane that contained three American military contractors. And they were there spying on FARC positions, sending videos back to the Southern Command in Florida that were eventually used in aggressive operations against the Colombian people. Mr. Trinidad never, ever had any personal knowledge, control, or anything over these people. But they charged him. They took him to Washington. And after four trials, he was convicted of one crime of conspiracy, which all lawyers know is the most broadest thing that you could ever imagine. Colombian government wanted to make an example of him, okay, to show that we can crush rebellion. Well, they couldn't. And he's become a symbol of resistance. He's become a symbol of peace. And there are peace talks going on in Cuba right now. To understand that, you have to get rid of one lie, that there are not peace talks going on because the popular movement in Colombia is weak. There are peace talks going on in Colombia because the popular movement is strong. And they continue to fight. They're strong politically, they're strong militarily, and they can't be defeated. He's been named one of their top five negotiators in the peace talks in Colombia. And there is a massive campaign to get him out and everywhere. The Colombian government, my God, the Colombian government is agreeable to him being released. The FARC have said they won't sign a peace agreement without they're there. The only impediment is our government here. So we have to call for Simon Trinidad to be released so that he can go and do this important work for peace. And there's the free Ricardo Palmera. He's also known as Ricardo Palmera. That's his birth name. They're circulating a petition here, and they're going to be doing activities, so please sign up. And I call for the freedom of Simon Trinidad. I call for the freedom of all political prisoners. And I ask you to support the Colombian peace process. And thank you very much for your time.
Okay. Thank you, Mark Burton. Our next speaker is El-Hajj Mauri Saalakhan, a metropolitan Washington, D.C.-based human rights advocate, author, lecturer, and poet. He is the founder of the Coalition Against Political Imprisonment, the National Association for Police Accountability, and the Peace Through Justice Foundation, a Washington, D.C.-based grassroots human rights organization. And Mr. Saalakhan is also the author of several books. Mauri Saalakhan. Oh, here he is. He's coming.
In the name of God, the compassionate, the merciful. Back in the mid-90s, I think it was 1995, there was a hearing held in downtown Philadelphia for Mumia Abu-Jamal. I remember getting on a crowded elevator, and the person standing next to me, who at the time was Mumia's lead defense counsel, was the late Leonard Wineglass. And he leaned over. I had never met him before. He leaned over to me in that crowded elevator and he said, "Congratulations on your victory on Terrence Johnson. I hope that we collectively can do the same for Mumia." That brief moment in that crowded elevator came to symbolize how I had inadvertently become the face of the campaign of a young man, a young African-American who was brutalized by Prince George's County Police when he was 15 years old. And ultimately, out of that brutalization, ended up doing almost 17 years. He was 15. And we became involved in his campaign. After the third time he was denied parole, and one of the African American weeklies did a petition drive on his behalf. That's how it came to our attention. Myself, a brother by the name of Mark Thompson, who was a head of a student organization on UDC's campus, a businessman by the name of Talib Ukda, the three of us formed this committee to work on his release. And after 3.5 years of dogged work in the court of public opinion, he was released. I chaired the committee. I became very closely identified with Terrence Johnson. And then something happened. About within 2 years of his release, he ended up killing himself under very troubling circumstances, shot himself. And that hurt me. It hurt me deeply, and I said out of that tragedy that I would never allow myself to become close to any case, emotionally close to any case again. And I didn't until Afia Siddiqui. Afia Siddiqui is a young Pakistani woman who came to the U.S. when she was 18 years old in 1990. She did her first year at the University of Houston, then she got a full scholarship to MIT. She went off to MIT, graduated with honors, went from there to Brandeis University, where she got a PhD in cognitive neuroscience. Brilliant young woman. Afia was also, or I should say, is also a Hafiza of Quran, meaning she has memorized the Quran. And she was very deeply committed to her faith. She was known at MIT and Brandeis for her dawah efforts and also for her humanitarian relief work. And because of this positive activism, she became a person of suspicion after 9/11. And that suspicion followed her home when she left the United States, went back to Pakistan in 2012, by this time married, 2 young children, a third one in her belly, and just months after she gets back home, in March of 2003, she is targeted for rendition. She and her 3 young children are kidnapped, disappeared, and for 5 years, no one knew where she was. And then in 2008, after 4 Arab Muslims escaped from Bagram in Afghanistan, she was kidnapped from Karachi, Pakistan, her home city. 5 years later, when 4 Arab men escaped from Bagram in Afghanistan and told stories about how they had been targeted for rendition, how they had been tortured, and they all told the story of this one woman whose name they didn't know, but they described her as a young Pakistani woman who had lived for a number of years in America, had been torn from her children, didn't know where they were. She was like a ghost prisoner to them. They would just see her from time to time, but they would hear her haunting screams on a daily basis, usually at night, because of what was being done to her. And as word got around far and wide, and people began to put pressure on the U.S. authorities who were controlling Bagram, the Pakistani authorities, because this is an American citizen, and Afghan, because this is their territory, to admit, number one, a woman was being held there, and number two, identify that who she was. We believe she is Afia Siddiqui. They released her on the streets of Ghazni in Afghanistan and then set her up to be killed. The short of it is, Afia ended up being shot, but she didn't die. She ended up getting emergency treatment, then was helivacked back to the United States, where she has been ever since. 12 years of wrongful imprisonment, 5 years of secret imprisonment overseas, followed by now 7 years of torturous imprisonment on a military base in Fort Worth, Texas, Carswell, FMC Carswell. And my brothers and sisters in struggle, I've often asked, why Afia, Brother Saalakhan, Mr. Saalakhan, Mauri Saalakhan, there are many cases. You've been involved in many. Why is it you feel so passionately about this woman? 1 minute. Why do you feel so passionately, as is evident, about this woman, this one prisoner? It is because, ladies and gentlemen, if I think Afia Siddiqui is a litmus test for us all. If the government can get away with doing this to a Muslim woman of Afia's caliber, none of us are safe. None of us are safe. And then the last point I want to make is because the health and welfare of this potentially great but deeply disturbed nation called America is also at stake. Sheikh Ibn Taymiyyah, who if he were alive today, he would be considered a militant, an extremist. He said something that was very true then and now, many, many, many generations ago. Civilization is based on justice, and the consequences of oppression are devastating. Therefore, it is said, Allah, God, aids the just state, even if it is non-Muslim, yet withholds itself from the oppressive state, even if it is Muslim. I have 1 minute?
You're getting an extra minute.
I'm getting an extra minute. Thank you so much. Well, let me say this. With this extra minute, I'm going to remind us all, especially those of us who have never visited the Jefferson Memorial in Washington, D.C., and walked up into this grand memorial and read some of the inscriptions on the wall. If you've never been there, there is one inscription that reads, and it mirrors what Sheikh Ibn Taymiyyah said many, many generations before Jefferson. And he didn't have the contradictions that Jefferson had. Jefferson wrote, I believe, in the wee hours of the morning to one of his close friends in a letter, I tremble for my country. When I reflect, God is just. His justice cannot sleep forever. We are here. We have convened this conference for the purpose of organizing a deeper well of pushback on the major human rights issues of the day. I pray to Almighty God that we all leave here re-energized and more deeply committed to bringing about that necessary change. Because if we don't, this nation is going to be as bad as some of us think it is now. 5 or 10 years from now, if this country remains on the trajectory that it's on, it's going to be many times worse. I love this country. I was born and raised here. It doesn't belong to the Bush family or the Clinton family or any of these others. This is part of God's earth. And I think it is my and our responsibility to do as much as we can to defend our land and to force it, if necessary, to live up to the better part of itself. May God bless us before this conference has ended to renew that type of commitment. The last thing I want to say is this. Our sister, Afia Siddiqui, she needs our collective support. What has been said about her, the official story of Afia Siddiqui, is just as ridiculous as the official account of 9/11. And right now she needs our support. If she doesn't get it, and I think Lynn, my sister Lynn, she knows this. If she doesn't get that support soon and she's not released soon, she's going to die soon on that military base in Texas. She needs an independent medical team to be allowed in to examine her, first to determine that she is still alive, because she has been so cut off that her family has not even been able to visit her in almost a year. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sharmin Sadequee is here. There she is, okay. Is our next speaker, and she's director of the Prisoners and Families Committee of the National Coalition to Protect Civil Freedom, where she supports and organizes families of Muslim political prisoners targeted in the domestic war on terror. As a prison abolitionist activist, prisoner rights advocate, organizer, and artist, she incorporates visual art in her academic and organizing work. Sharmin Sadequee.
Zurata Duka's voice cracked in tears as she recounted the invasion of our peaceful home by federal agents in 2007. She was washing dishes on a quiet evening when the door to her home in New Jersey exploded as if it had been bombed. 10 or more massive men in SWAT suits stormed in, pointing rifles and guns at her. Terrified, she lifted up a chair to protect herself from the intruders and screamed at the federal agents, "Don't touch me! I'm Muslim. Please let me put my headscarf on." But the agents threw her onto her kitchen floor, slammed her to the ground, and pushed her face down. They handcuffed her hands behind her back and forced her to stay in that position. Then they ransacked her home for over 5 hours, looking for guns and weapons. They found none. Zurata and her husband and their three little sons, Drytan, Shane, and LG Duka, was entrapped, along with their two friends, were entrapped by an FBI informant in South New Jersey. And I start with this to basically grab your attention to me. The investigation was led by Governor Chris Christie, who was then leading the U.S. Attorney's Office. I feel really humbled and privileged to be part of this panel. The political prisoners included in this panel is where I learned my work to do the work that I do with the National Coalition to Protect Civil Freedoms around the Muslim post-9/11 Muslim political prisoner. So this wasn't my speech. I'm going to read my speech now. So I'm here as a sister of a political prisoner, my brother Shifa Siddiqui. I'm also here as someone who works closely with families of post-9/11 Muslim political prisoners whose loved ones have been profiled, targeted, entrapped, incarcerated by the new liberal military prison, and I'm going to borrow from Ray McGovern, corporate security intelligence, and add Islamophobia's white supremacist industrial complex of a declining empire in fear of losing its glory. And it wants to persist by instilling paranoia and using Muslims as a new scapegoat under the guise of protecting national security in the war of manipulating human emotions as the rhetoric war on terror, but it's actually a war of terrorism on all our communities. As we can see in the context of Zurata. About my brother. My brother was born and raised in the US. He is fluent in Arabic, in Quranic, the ancient Arabic, and was translating political, religious literature, which some may find distasteful because they're political in nature. from Arabic to English and publishing them in an online publication, Tibian Publications. If you know of Tariq Mahanna's case, he was also translating for the same publication. And he was connecting with youth. Tariq Mahanna and my brother, they knew each other from this publication. And they're basically, you know, exchanging ideas and talking about the wars abroad and their frustrations about what a Muslim need to be doing in this context. My brother was working with my sister, who's a political activist in Atlanta, Georgia, in a women's rights organization that focused on ending violence against women. He volunteered with organizations such as Women's Actions for New Directions, as many of us know, is a national organization whose mission is to empower women to act politically, reduce militarism and violence around the world. He spoke out against the U.S. violence in Iraq and Afghanistan, helped organize anti-war protests in Atlanta, Georgia with my sister and with the progressive community there. He was a community leader. He used to give Friday sermons in Atlanta and also in Bangladesh. So he was a community leader, preacher, and a teacher in the making. He was an inspirational speaker. If anybody comes across, talks to him, and they always, you know, he's very motivational. So that was threatening to the U.S. government. He went to a Muslim school in Canada for a short while and then went to Bangladesh in 2005. He also lived in Bangladesh for a while. Returned here, then went back to get married. And 12 days after he was married, in April of 2006, the U.S. government had him kidnapped off the street when he and his wife was returning home after a post-wedding shopping. And they made him disappear for a couple of days. He was blindfolded, punched, kicked, and the FBI renditioned him in a secret CIA aircraft. So Shifa is one of the first young Muslim men to represent himself at his own trial in the federal court system, and we need to understand this act as a political statement when prisoners do that. He had four charges, but he was sentenced to 17 years, four charges that had 60 years, and he was sentenced to 17 years and is currently located in Communications Management Unit. In the context of the war on terror, the myth of national security that is used as justification to target Muslims and all of our communities has affected all our communities. And as families targeted, we already know the state has chosen our innocent loved ones as the scapegoat, and they bear the brunt of state's most egregious imperialistic counterterrorism measures. The state has targeted our community leaders, teachers, and preachers, or those who appear to possess those characteristics. In other contexts, the state has also targeted the most vulnerable members of our community. Members of our community. This targeting of Muslims at home, as we know, is connected to the broader expansion of the imperial carceral state and its neoliberal capitalist political agendas abroad, trying to control Muslims and other communities of color to rule over the world. This impacts our collective safety and freedom. And when our collective safety and freedom is taken away and attacked, that's a form of violence in all our communities. Despite these measures, the families feel isolated and alienated within the larger American communities, society, and within their own Muslim community. However, we remain resilient in the face of this state violence. We will not stop fighting for our loved ones. They have committed no crime, certainly no act of violence. They're all political prisoners. We will continue to expose the rights violations in federal courts and prisons and the state violence that we have been made to endure. My presence here represents the resistance to this violence of this imperial state. So we must unite, organize, and expose this inherent imperial violence in all our struggles and movements. And make sure that political prisoners should be included as the center and front of all our struggles and demand the release of all our political prisoners. Thank you so much.
Our next speaker is the oldest of my friends in this room. We graduated Jamaica High School together in 1958. And when Lynne Stewart comes up here, we are going to sing you the school song. Lynne is a brilliant attorney. No matter what the government says, when they took away her license to practice, She defended more political prisoners than you can ever imagine. And when the former Attorney General of the United States asked her to defend the blind Sheikh Omar Abdel Rahman, she took the assignment. And she had to fight for her very life. When I first met her in California, she got in the front seat of my car, and this very handsome young man got in the back seat, and she pointed to him and said, "Jeff, I'd like to introduce you to Ralph Pointer, my husband." And I said, "The Ralph Pointer?" And Ralph said, "What do you mean, the Ralph Pointer?" And I said, "The Ralph Pointer who led the struggle of the black community against the racist Shanker school strike in 68? He said, "That's me." And I was side by side with Lynne on standing up against a racist strike. Now, Lynne has a stupid side. I want to tell you about it. She's sitting there as a defendant in her own behalf. And she says, "Why didn't you wait if you disagreed with this special administrative order? Why didn't you file a grievance?" And there's a jury with her life in her hand. And Lynne says, "Well, I have this friend named Mumia Abu-Jamal. With your life at stake," she talks to the jury about a friend of hers who is a convicted murderer, in quotes. And she said, and the government opened up his mail, and he had to file a suit for the right to have correspondence with his attorney secret, and he had to wait 9 months, and I didn't want to wait 9 months to defend the rights of my client. Ooh. And then, when Mike Tiger, her attorney, asked her the last second on the witness stand, because Lynne passed out a press release for her client, Omar Abdel Rahman, Mike said to her, "Lynne, if you had to do it all over again, would you do the same thing?" Now, any smart person would say, "Oh, I made a mistake. I mean, I wasn't thinking what I was doing." But Lynne, and I was right there, with a tear rolled down her voice, down her face, she said, "I would hope, I would do it again." And for that, this government put her in jail for 10 years, first three, and then when she walked out into the street after the 27-month sentence, and the media, there were five, how many of you were there when she walked out the first time? And the media, as a reporter said, "How do you feel about 27 months? And Lynne, who had her toothpaste in a plastic bag ready to go to jail for 10 years, said, "I think I can do 27 months standing on her head." And the government said, "That's not what they, what do they call it? You didn't show enough contriteness." The government, the federal government, intervened, demanded that the judge resentence her, put the screws on him, and she gave her 10 years, which was a death sentence. And she's here today for two reasons. She wouldn't give up, and we didn't give up, and that's why we have a free Lynne Stewart!
May be the most beautiful word in the English language. I know it was to me for many years, almost five. Home, to go home, to be home. And I know it is for my brothers and sisters who remain behind bars. All they want
is to be home. So what to do? The fact that there are so many political prisoners expresses or betrays the weakness and the ineffectiveness of our movement. Except, and I am one of the exceptions, there are others. I am home. And I am home as my dear friend and the West Coast coordinator has said, I am home because of the support and the insistence that I come home of all of you and countless others who may not be on our same page of revolutionary necessity, but who understood that this was wrongful, this was overborne, and it must be rolled back. So thousands of people signed petitions, hundreds of people came out to rallies and court events. My dear Ralph, that handsome young man, stood in front of the White House in 100-degree heat, mostly by himself, but with various groups coming to join him on certain occasions, and said, let her go home. And home I came, and I am home today. And I received a letter. Actually, Ralph received this letter because I don't communicate with political prisoners because it's part of my probation. So Ralph writes all the letters, and Ralph got a letter from Mutulu Shakur. All right. Who only happens to be an acupuncturist who figured out a way to deal with heroin addiction, but of course they put him in jail. And also was a member of the Black Liberation Army. I think I'm free to say that. Anyway, Ralph got a letter from Mutulu, and the letter said, the men who wait behind bars are waiting for us to free them. We are their only hope, and their faith is greater than any religion. Their faith in our movement. We cannot betray that faith. Pam has talked to you about Mumia and his desperate situation, which we are trying to get past a point of no return. I am going to spend the rest of my time, and I tell you, I am feeling fairly fit. My doctors say I am at a point where my cancer is not advancing. It's not retreating, but it's not advancing. And I hope using my own daughter, our own daughter, as a foundation, Dr. Zenobia Brown, to put together a medical cadre that we could have on call, because our political prisoners are aging. They are in desperate shape, as talked to about Dr. Siddiqui and her, what situation she is in. And I feel that if we have a medical cadre that's willing to step in, even if it's just to read medical records, which the government and the jails must give up, that will be a step in the right direction. So if you know a decent doctor, and that may be a contradiction, but if you know a decent doctor who might be willing to do some work for pro bono, for the good, please be in touch with me. We also need lawyers, because we have good lawyers, but not enough of them. I called a good lawyer the other day about one of the political prisoners, and she told me a number of things she thought about the case, and then said, but of course I'll need a $50,000 retainer. I said to myself, I too was a lawyer, but there wasn't a political prisoner who could call me that I had to have a retainer for. I did the work. for the good, for the good, for the good of all. So we need lawyers. If you know young lawyers that want to cut their tooth on movement activities, and they write to me still and say, what do you do to be a movement lawyer? And I say, join the movement and defend it. And I'm going to talk about the no-no, the big pink elephant that sits in the room whenever we talk about political prisoners. And that is, their targets were often blue. Cops. And people always say, oh, but he killed a cop. Mumia, but he killed a cop. Oh, he's convicted. That was then. This is now. When they acted out of the defense of their community, which was under attack. If you were alive in the 60s, you know what was happening in the black community. You know of the riots and the fires and the deaths of people like Clifford Glover in Jamaica, New York, a 10-year-old killed by a cop. But because the Panthers were out there and then BLA, you know, it was remarkably quiet during those years. There were not those killings. There was another force to be contended with. So whether you believe, as I do, that the best defense is an offense, you must believe that these men have served more than enough time, and that if we are to ever defeat the police state, we should start with freeing political prisoners and get rid of the myth that somehow a cop's life is worth more than anybody else's. My young friend is not holding up any signs, so I definitely want to mention, any of you are in or around New York or want to come to be in and around New York on May 30th, Memorial Day weekend. Oh, it isn't the weekend. It's the week after. I got an extra minute from Mackler. He has to do that. If you're in or around New York, that's when the great march will be for Oscar Lopez Rivera, the remaining political prisoner from Puerto Rico. And they are all home, and we want to bring Oscar home. And closer at hand, for all you residents of Secaucus, closer at hand, though, on the 13th of May in Philadelphia is the commemoration of one of the most infamous acts, and there are plenty of them, the bombing of the Move family, of which Pam Africa is a member, and of which there are still nine, is it Pam, or eight? Eight Move members still in jail? Seven. One passed recently. Once again, we don't have the doctors that can tell us what to do in those situations yet. Probably. Medical neglect is the name of the game, and I want to say to you, I know that too. But at any rate, there is going to be a big commemoration of that date because it is a date we should remember. I know I can, you know, people say, where were you when Kennedy was killed? Where were you in 9/11? But I can also remember, where was I on May 13th, 85, when the word came out about the dropping of the bomb on innocent black civilians. So if you can get to Philadelphia, by any means possible, please be there. Commemorate. Show that this is a date we all recognize and understand to be important. So I said earlier that we have had successes. I'm here. I would say the fact that Russell Maroon Schultz is no longer in solitary confinement after, 25 years is a victory. I would say that there are other victories out there to be won, and we can do them. We can have little victories for people, but we can have big victories too. And I think the only thing it takes is solidarity, resistance, understanding that it cannot be neglected. This is not something to put on your back burner. These people are aging. They are sometimes, Matulu also wrote that they wanted to amputate his leg. And he said, no, you can't do that. And then they found out what was really wrong with him and that amputation was not on the table, so as to speak. So I just want to say, we must have more than rhetoric. We must have action. If you are called upon, whether wherever you live, please answer. Answer that call on behalf of people who are in jail because they believed, as many of us do, in the freedom and equality of all people. Thank you.